In today's class, we are going to talk about animal association. So we are studying this topic, animal association or animal interaction, under the course aquatic ecology. Why we are studying the animal association aquatic ecology? Because ecology is a science that deals with the relationship between the organism and environment. Or we can see that we used to study the interrelationship of the biotic and the abiotic factor in an ecosystem. Okay, that all comes under the ecology. Suppose if there is one organism which is in particular ecosystem. Okay, so what happens? It must interact with abiotic and biotic components of the environment. Okay, it has an impact of the surrounding water. If it is aquatic animal, it has impact of the surrounding water, or if it is still animal, the surrounding air, the matter, the earth crust. So many abiotic factor affects the organism life. And even when we talk about the biotic components, means the, if an organism in an ecosystem, then there must be other organisms, the plants or animals or microbes. Okay, so even other biotic factor, other plants, animals or microorganism also affect the organism. Okay, so basically in the ecosystem, all these organisms, all these biotic as well as abiotic factor interacts, okay, and then they form a complete ecosystem. So that is why we are going to discuss, or we are going to study the animal association or animal interaction under the aquatic ecology topic, okay. So today we will discuss about the various type of animal association, okay. This animal association or the interrelationship between different animals of an ecosystem, okay, it may be of direct type or indirect, it may be of interspecific or intraspecific. So various kind of interactions occurs between the animal which exist together in an ecosystem. So whenever we talk about any environment, okay, or any ecosystem, no organism can be able to live alone without having interaction with the other organism, okay? And this interaction are very essential as well as of various type. The interaction of one species with the other species is important for the purpose of obtaining food, shelter, and for meeting many other essential requirements. That is why whenever there is an ecosystem, there is an organism, needs to interact with other organism for so many things. So basically we can see that for the survival. Okay, so when this interaction or interdependence or the interrelationship between occurs between the individual of the same species, suppose there is a one pond in which there is around 1,000 fishes of same species. 1,000 fishes of same species, and if they interact, they have some interrelationship of, okay, for anything, for competition, for food, for predation, okay, then that type of relationship is known as intraspecific relationship, means the individual of the same species have the relationship or the interaction, okay, and there is another group of relationship which is known as the interspecific relationship. This is a relationship which exists between the organisms of different species. Okay, suppose one species from one group interacts, whether in a positive manner or a negative manner, with the species of the different group. So that kind of relationship is known as an interspecific relationship. So when we talk about the interspecific relationship, these relationships are of two types. Okay. The one is a positive, either these two organisms have the positive relationship or the negative relationship. So when we talk about the positive relationship, it is a relationship where both the partner, both the species are benefited, or at least neither are harmed. Okay, either one is benefited or both the benefited, but none of the species in that relationship will be harmed. Okay, but when we talk about the negative relationship, at least one partner of the species, one partner in this relationship will be harmed. So that type of relationship is known as a negative relationship. So Now see what are the different type of animal interrelationship or association exist. So there is the main type of the animal association that we are going to discuss today is symbiosis. Okay. Symbiosis is basically the relationship where we study the interdependence of the living organism. There is basically three type of symbiotic relationship exists in the animal, that is the mutualistic relationship, commensalistic relationship, and parasitic relationship. There are some other association also, but in those associations, the interdependence is not mandatory. Okay, like the cooperation, competition, and predation. So we are going to discuss all these six type of animal association in today's class. So first we talk about what is symbiosis. So the word symbiosis has a Greek origin, which is originated from the Greek word symbion. Symbion means to live together. So symbiosis is basically a term which is used for the interdependence of different species, okay, which are the participating partners are known as symbiont, okay. As I have told, there are three main types of symbiotic relationship, which depicts the specific relationship between the species involved. So the number one is the mutualism, then the commensalism, and the third one is the parasitism. So we will discuss first what are the basic type of this relationship. When we talk about the mutualism, it is the relationship in which both the organism, means if the mutualistic relationship occurs between two organisms, or okay, from different species or from the same species, but if the two organisms are together, okay, in a relationship, in an interaction, so what happened, both organisms are benefited, okay. So this kind of symbiotic relationship is known as mutualistic relationship or mutualism. Then second one is the commensalism. In this relationship, one organism is benefited, but another is not benefited, neither benefited nor harmed. Okay, so this kind of relationship is known as commensalism. Then the parasitic relationship. This is the relationship in which the one organism which is known as a parasite is benefited, and the another organism which is known as a host may be harmed. Okay, so this is the basic types of symbiotic relationship. In the mutual relationship, both the organism get benefited, they have mutual dependence on each other. In commensalistic relationship, one organism is benefited, another is neither harmed nor benefited. In third relationship, that is a parasitism, in this relationship, the one partner, which is a parasite, is benefited and the host is harmed. These are some other relationship like cooperation. Here it refers to the beneficial interaction of same kind of organism. Okay, they do not become independent of each other, but when they work together, okay, they are benefited. Okay, then predation is also a relationship between the predator and its prey. Okay, then commensalism. Okay, commensalism is actually opposing to the commensalism. In commensalism, basically, the biological interaction where one species causes the harm to the another organism. But when it causes the harm to the another organism, it doesn't receive anything benefited for itself. Okay, means they are harming other organism, but in cost of that, they are not getting any benefit. Okay, that is called as commensalism. Then it is of two types. One is the competition and another one is the antibiasis. Okay, so we will take it in detail with example. Now the very first one is the mutualism. As I have told, this is a relationship where both the organisms are benefited. Okay, so it means their relationship is mutual. One species A benefit species B benefit species A. This is also of two type. Okay, there is basically two type of mutualistic relationship. One is the obligate mutualistic relationship, another one is the facultative. Obligate means this is a permanent type of relationship between two symbiotes. It means ki they are in close contact, they are interdependent to each other, and if they both get separated, okay, they cannot survive. That is known as a obligate or mutualistic relationship. This kind of partners or symbiont, they are physiologically connected, means they have their mutual relationship is necessary to perform certain physiological process or the life saving or life supporting process in both the partners. Okay, that's why this kind of relationship is known as obligate. Second one is facultative or mutualistic relationship, or the facultative mutualism. In this type of mutualism, what happened? They are attached to each other. They benefit each other for short duration. But if they get apart, okay, if they are not in the close association, it doesn't mean they will lose their life or they cannot survive without each other. Okay, this kind of mutualism is known as facultative mutualism. So we'll see some of the examples of obligate mutualism as well as facultative mutualism. So here is one of the example of the obligatory mutualism. You must have heard the name of the hermit crab. Okay, in the taxonomy class, taxonomy of shellfish, we talked about the hermit crab. So the relationship, the animal association between the hermit crab and the sea animal, it is one of the example of the obligatory mutualism. Okay, the hermit crab actually lives in the empty shell of some of the gastropods. Okay, and the outer surface of the gastropod, here you can see that. Here and in this drawing, you can see that the outer surface of the shell is attached or inhabited by the sea animals. Okay, so what happened? The hermit crab is protected from the enemy. How? Because the nematocyst of the sea animal protect the hermit crab from the predators. Okay, and so isse kya hua? Hermit crab is getting the benefit from the sea animal in terms of getting protection from the predators. And what sea animal get in the returns? It basically derive food from the hermit crab, and it also helps in the transportation of sea animal from one place to the another. So here you can see that they both get benefited from each other. Then another example of the obligatory mutualism is the giant. Okay, so the relationship between the giant clam and photosynthetic algae, a group of algae which is known as zooxanthellae. Okay, so the relationship between the giant clam and zooxanthellae is a kind of obligatory mutualism. Okay, what happened? Here you can see that this is the empty shell of the giant clam. This is the larva, which is this showing the life, means the animal which have both the zooxanthellae and the clam, and here is the empty shell. You can see that this shell is quite heavy, and they actually lives in the shallow coastal water where light penetrates easily. Okay, there is plenty of light because they are on the coastal, they live on the coastal region of the seabed. So what happened? So their mantle harbors the great population of symbiotic photosynthetic algae, which is known as zooxanthellae. Okay, so what happened? The calm shell, okay, it cannot close, okay, because it is very heavy. So it is open. In the open area, this population resides, and because they are on the coast, they actually provide the suitable environment for photosynthesis. Because they are on the coast, so there is a plenty of light. So because of that plenty of light, what happened? The plenty of light coming, so they are using that light to carry out the photosynthesis. Okay, so basically the symbiotic algae zooxanthellae, which is in association with the giant clam, they are getting their food. Okay, and so iske badle giant clams ko kya mil raha hai? The giant clams, they get the nutrient. Okay. Okay, so the zooxanthellae provide the nutrient to the clam also, and the clam gives the accommodation to the algae and photosynthetic algae, and algae gives the food to the giant clam. So this is also, both are getting benefited by this relationship. So this is also one of the example of the mutualism. Now another one is the corals and the algae. You must have read the name of the coral reef. Now, Kadai?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, jitni bhi coral reefs hoti, they are actually inhabited. So, coral reefs are basically, that is a complete ecosystem. The coral reef is complete ecosystem. So many species, so many organisms, animal, plant factor, microorganisms, they all are together, okay? They are interdependent, and so entire ecosystem exists there, okay? So the most of these reef building corals, okay, when the corals, they propagate and they simply form the the forest of them, or means when they propagate, their number increases, they basically build the wall kind of structure or protective structure, okay, which is known as a reef. So the coral reefs, okay, so coral reef, the corals which form the reef-like structure, they contain the photosynthetic algae that is called zooxanthellae, okay? So these zooxanthellae, they actually lives in the tissue of the corals, okay? And this is the relationship between the corals and algae is also a mutualistic relationship. How? The coral provides algae the protected environment, okay? And the compound they need for the photosynthesis, okay? And in return, the algae produce the oxygen and help the coral to remove the waste, okay? So in this kind of relationship, basically both the animals getting the benefit from each other, because where these coral reefs exist, they are actually the nutrient poor tropical water, okay? So if there is a nutrient is very less, there is a requirement of tight recycling of the nutrients. So basically this mutualistic relationship between the corals and the algae, it actually helps in the tight recycling of the nutrients, okay? So in this relationship also, both the animals get benefited. That's why it is the mutualistic relationship. Now another one is, these are some of the image of the corals, which have the different kind of zooxanthellae algae. Now, some of the facultative mutualism examples. Okay, here you can see that bees and the flower. Okay, so in this relationship, bees get the food in the term of flower sap. Okay, and what the benefit flower gets? It get pollinated. Okay, or the insects help in the reproduction in the flower, and insect or bees get the sap or the food from the flower. So this is a facultative. Why facultative? If this relationship is not permanent, if a bee can get the food from other flower also, and this flower can also help in the pollination or reproduction by other insect also, okay? But here both are benefited, that's why it is the facultative mutualistic relationship. Another one is between the oxpecker and the rhinoceros or zebra kind of animal. The oxpecker are basically birds, small birds, okay? So what they do, the oxpecker, they actually land on the back of the rhinoceros or the zebra, and they used to eat the ticks or the parasites which are present on their skin, okay? So what happened? The oxpecker get the food, okay, and the bees, like the zebra or the rhinoceros, they get the pest control, okay. So both are getting the benefit from each other. Oxpecker getting the food, and the zebra or rhinoceros or other cattles, they gets the pest control. Then there is another example of the facultative mutualism is the between the crocodile and plover bird. Okay, so crocodile get mouth clean from the food residue. This plover birds, it used to sit inside the mouth of the crocodile, and they used to clean the meat which is stuck between the teeth. Okay, so plover birds get the food from the teeth, and in return, the crocodile mouth gets cleaned, okay, from the food residue. Now, there is another example of the facultative mutualism is the cleaner shrimp and the grouper fish. Cleaner shrimp used to go inside the grouper's mouth and they simply picks off the parasites which are present inside the grouper's mouth, okay, or they are present in the gills. So shrimp getting the food and the grouper fish here, it gets benefit from the removal or pick off the parasites. So this is also example of the facultative mutualism. Now we will talk about the commensalism. Okay, as I have told, this is also a symbiotic relationship, but in this relationship where there is a two different species living together, one partner or a species is benefited and the other partner or other species is neither benefited nor harmed. Okay, this term of commensalism is have the Latin origin with from the word commensa, which means sharing a table as guest messmate. Okay, and in commensalism there is no physiological interdependence. In mutualism, we have seen in the obligatory mutualism there is a physiological interdependence among the partners. Okay, but here there is no physiological interdependence among the partners. Okay, so the purpose of this relationship is to get food, or maybe sometime to get space or shelter, defense, transport. Like mutualism, the commensalism also so have many purpose in this relationship. For some relationship, it is for food. For some, it is for space. For some, shelter, defense, or transport. Okay. If and on the basis of the location of the commensals, okay, or the partners on the host, it may be grouped into the endocommensals or the ectocommensal. Okay, and even if there is also, if we am talking about the association based on the level of association, it is also two type. One is the permanent commensalism and another one is the temporary commensalism. So here is one of the example of the permanent commensalism. Here you can see that anyone can recognize ye kya hai. We have studied this, no? They are basically branchials. Okay, they are branchials. They are molars. They permanently attach to the body surface of whales, even in some turtles. Okay, or on the body surface of the shark. So these branchials are attached to the whale or other animals, but they are not obtaining any food from the tissue of the host. Okay, but means they are do not obtaining anything like the food, or they are not harming the host animal. Okay, but they provide the substrate for branchial. Okay, substrate for the attachment of branchial, so that it can move from here to the another place. So here what we can see that the branchials get the benefit because they get the body surface for the attachment, but whale or the host like whale, turtle or shark, they won't get any benefit, but they are not harmed by the branchials. Another one is the temporary commensalism. Okay, there are some of the example in the temporary commensalism. Okay, this is for certain period of time. This contact is temporary. When we see the example of branchial in males, okay, that is permanent. Once the branchial is attached to the body, it will attach till it dies. Okay, but in the temporary commensalism, this contact is intermittent. Okay, kabhi contact mein rahenge, kabhi nahi rahenge. That intermittent contact is sometimes for food, for shelter, or for breeding to reach the breeding site. Okay, so some of the example is the temporary commensalism between the shakar fish and shark. Okay, Polynox and Cetipteris, then Portuguese man of war and fishes. Okay, so we will see these examples. They are very interesting examples of the temporary commensalism in the marine animals. First we will see the shark and the shakar fish. Okay, shakar fish, they used to attach with the body of the shark. Okay, and when they get attached, okay, on the body of the shark, they get the free food and the transport. Okay, but shark, it neither benefited nor harmed. This is one of the commensalistic relationship. There is another example of the decapod crustacean. Okay, the decapod crustacean polynix lives. This is the decapod crustacean, which lives in the U-tube of the marine annelid Caetopteris. Okay, so what happened when it enters inside this, it gets the food particle, it also gets the oxygen supply from the water which is entering inside the U-tube by the pumping action of the annelid. In return, this annelid doesn't get anything from the crustacean. So this is also a type of commensalistic relationship. Then another example is the Portuguese man of war. Okay, there is a one species, this is Physalia salts, which is commonly known as Portuguese man of war. Here you can see that this is the species, Portuguese man of war, Physalia. It's here you can see that it have very long tentacles. Okay, with the help of these tentacles, they use to kill the small size fishes which is coming around and consume them. Okay, so these tentacles are very poisonous with, and they are very long also. With the help of these free flowing tentacles, they use to kill the small fishes which is swimming around, and then they used to consume it. So, but there is also a commensalistic relationship found between the Portuguese man of war, and there is a one small fish which is known as a Nemus. Okay, Nemus species. What they do? They used to live and move between the tentacles of these Portuguese man of war without getting affected. Okay, means they are just moving around these tentacles. These fishes, they are moving silently. Okay, around these tentacles without getting the toxic or the poisonous sting, and they actually get the food, okay, from this which is coming around, means which is consumed by the, or which is killed by these Portuguese man of war of Physalia. But in return, this animal doesn't get anything from those fishes. Okay, so this is also one of the example of the commensalism. Then now, the types of commensalistic relationship: apozoism, androecism, and inquilinism. Okay, we'll see one by one. If I'm talking about apozoism, means many sedentary marine animals. Okay, they are episodic, meaning they are setting facultative or even obligatory on other, particularly in those with a hard shell. Means bahut sare aise animals hain, sedentary marine animals hain, for which are for the movement, for transportation from one place to the other. This transportation may be for food, may be for feeding, may be getting the protection or shelter. So there are several marine sedentary animals which actually settled off, okay, or attach themselves on the body of some of the coelids, hydroids, bryos, some of the on the shell of the lemibranch, gastropods or crustaceans. Okay, so that kind of relationship is known as the apozoism, commensalistic relationship. Then there is another relationship which is known as endemism. Okay, endemism, in which animal habitually takes shelter within the tube or burrow of the another. There are some examples here. I'll show you some of the examples. Annelids, some crustacea, okay, which are the host of many commensal, means their shells, okay, they actually, the some of the animals or the worms, they go inside their body, inside their shell, inside the clam or crab, and there they lives, okay, inside this cell, okay, and from there they get the protection as well as the food. In turn, the host doesn't get anything. Then another relationship, in which one lives within the another, okay, and it utilizing the host animal mainly as refuge. Okay, means jab unka man karta hai uske andar jaate hain, they get the protection, they get the food, and whenever they want, they just come out from that. There is one of the example, very interesting example, is the pearl fish. Okay, Pearlfish used to dwell inside the intestine of the sea cucumber. Whenever they want, they just simply enter inside the through the rectum. They enter inside the intestine. They get the food there. They get the shelter. And whenever they want to come outside, they simply come outside there. Here we can see that. You can see that this is the sea cucumber, and this is the fish, the pearlfish. Here it is coming out from the rectum of the animal. Okay, here you can see this is the rectal opening, and this is the mouth of the fish. So this pearlfish, which is a Carpus acus, it enters inside the sea cucumber. It gets the shelter there. It gets the food there. And whenever it's basically it lives inside the gut of the sea cucumber. Okay, so this fish getting all the benefit from the sea cucumber, but in return sea cucumber doesn't get anything. So this is also one of the example of the commensalistic relationship. Okay, now the third symbiotic relationship is the parasitic relationship. Okay, in this type of relationship, one animal or the species is benefited at the expense of the other. Means the parasite, which is getting the benefit, it causing the harm to the host. Okay, and this the parasitic relationship is also temporary or permanent. Okay, if the parasite completes the entire life inside on the host, inside or the outside, means ecto or endo, it is known as a permanent. And sometimes a certain life stage of a parasite is inside certain host, that situation is known as the temporary parasitic relationship. So here we'll see some of the examples of the parasitic relationship. So one is the temporary parasite. Here the organism spend only some portion, some part of its life as a parasite on the host. Okay, as example are the lampreys. Okay, lampreys actually get attached to the marine fish. They suck the blood from the large fishes with its suckers, and after some time they simply leave the host. Okay, so this type of parasitic relationship is known as a temporary or facultative parasitic relationship. There is another interesting example of the Clostridium larva. Clostridium larva is the larvae of freshwater mussels, okay, freshwater clams. So on their Clostridium larva, they actually attach to the larvae of the host fish, okay, with the help of a structure, which is a hook-like structure, which is present on the Clostridium larva. So when they, this larva, they simply get attached with the help of that hook-shaped structure on the gill of the fish, and where they get the food. Okay, I'm audible.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay,
yes, ma'am.
So I was at this slide, okay, the temporary parasite. So as I am telling, the temporary parasite means the organism or the parasitic partner which spends some stage of their life on the host. In other stages, they actually free living. So this kind of parasites are known as the temporary parasites. There are some very good examples. One is the lampreys. Okay, lampreys are the primitive. The lampreys actually, they attached with the help of the suckers which have at their mouths to the body of the marine fish, and they suck the blood from the large fishes. Okay, and after sucking the blood or getting the food, they simply get detached from the host, or they simply leave the host. Okay. So this type of parasitic is known as a facultative or parasitic or temporary parasitic relationship. There is another example is the Glochidium larvae. Okay, so Glochidium larvae is actually the larvae of the freshwater mussel or the freshwater bivalves. Okay, so what this Glochidium actually, the Glochidium larva in the initial stage is the parasitic larvae. The Glochidium larvae is a parasitic larvae. What happened? When this larvae is comes outside the body of the mussels, it get attached to the gills of the fishes. Okay, this Glochidium larvae have a hook-like structure, and that hook simply get stuck with the or attached with the gills of the fishes. From there, they are getting the food. Okay, they basically sucks the gill sap. Okay, so they are getting the food from the host fish. Okay, and when they attain the maturity stage or then what happens, they simply get detached from the host fish and leads a free benthic life. Okay, so Glochidium larvae is also the temporary parasites of the fish. Okay, so this is also one of the example of the temporary parasite. Then another one is permanent parasites. Okay, the permanent parasites are basically two type of parasites. They are parasites which spend entire life. Okay, their entire life inside the host. These kind of parasites are known as the permanent parasites. Okay, and they are basically divided into two categories. One is the ectoparasite, another one is the endoparasite. Ectoparasites are the external parasites, and the endoparasites are the parasite which lives inside the body of the host. Okay, so there are several examples of the parasites, permanent parasites. Okay, when we talk about the endoparasite, then Trypanosoma, flukes, there are several examples. Okay, in humans, in fishes, okay, so many examples are there, which actually lives on outer surface, permanently on the outer surface of the animal, or inside the host fish animal. Okay, so hello, I'm audible.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes,
okay.
Ma'am.
Okay, actually, बहुत ज़्यादा network का problem है, बार-बार disconnect हो रहा है. Okay, so these are the permanent parasites, which are the parasite which spends their entire life inside the host. Then there is another category of the parasite which is known as the hyperparasite. Okay. This kind of relationship is known as the hyperparasitism. In here, the parasites, okay, parasites also the host of the another parasite. Okay, means the organism which is parasite. Suppose there is organism A which is a parasite on organism B. Okay, so organism B is the host for parasite A, but there is another parasite which is or another organism which is organism C, which is the host, which is the parasite for the organism A. Getting my point? Means the parasites themselves are parasitized by other organism. Okay, such parasites are known as hyperparasites. Okay, there is one of the example is Nosema notabilis is a hyperparasite on Mezosporidium. Okay, so basically they are the common parasites of the urinary bladder of the toadfishes. Okay, so this is another category of the hyperparasitism. Now we will talk about the other examples, the other association. Till we have discussed about the association, the symbiotic association, where there is an interrelationship between the animals. We talk about mutualism, we talk about commensalism, we talk about parasitism. Now we will talk about some other association which is not symbiotic, but if they are together or they are apart, it affects the life of the individuals which have some interrelationship or interdependency of each other. So the number one is the cooperation. Okay, so how the cooperation helps in the survival of the animals. Okay, if we take the examples of human itself, suppose we are actually, we used to tell us we are the social animals, is it? We are the social animal. How? Because we lives in a community. We lives in a community. Sometimes we our relationship is not physiological, means we are not physiologically independent to the other, but because we lives in a community, we lives in a society, we used to benefit each other. Okay, suppose if we talk about the marriage system, okay, particularly in India, where the most of the marriages used to be extravagant, if, even if it is not extravagant, the marriage is a big social affair in our country, is it? So what happened in the marriages, so many people used to come, our close relatives, they used to come, okay, our neighbors, which are, we are in very good terms, they used to come, and they all together prepare for the marriage, is it? Some people are taking care of the catering, few people are helping in the shopping, few are arranging the means lodging ka arrangement kar rahe ki guests kahan rukenge, barat kahan rukenge, bahut sare arrangements hote hai na. What we used to do, aisa nahi hai ki jinke paas kam log hai ya jinke kam dost hai wo log shaadiyan nahi arrange kar sakte, but if there is a cooperation from large number of people, what we used to have, we get the things get done easier. Okay, so that is also kind of example of the animal association in cooperation. So here we'll see some of the example, like the cooperative hunting. Here you can see that these are the group of lions. Okay, they are hunting together for the food. Okay, so if they will hunt together, there is a greater chance, the greater possibility to get the food first, is it? So this is the cooperative hunting. In several animals, they used to hunt together. Okay, so this cooperative hunting increase the chance of success, so they will get the food easily. And if they are in a group, okay, so the attack by other predators on them is also reduced. Okay, so this kind of relationship is known as a cooperation. Then another is the example of the ants. Okay, here what happened, there are several ants, they forage in a group for food collection. Okay, so what they work in a community, they actually all, so many ants, they work together, they carry the food and they simply preserve it in their dens. Okay, so these are some of the example of the cooperation in the animal association. Then next one is predation. Okay, predation, prey and predator, that is also a relationship. Okay, this is also a kind of relationship. Here the one animal is killed, okay, and the other animal gets the food. So that is also a dependence, interdependence of each other. So the prey and predator relationship is also an animal association. The predator is a one organism which is killed, which kills the prey, okay, which belongs to the other species for food. And the animal which killed the prey is known as, which kills is known as a predator, and which is killed is known as a prey. Okay, so There are several examples of predation, prey and predation. There's some animals they use to feed on the insects. Okay, some insects they use to feed on the plants. There are several other examples you can see where you can look into the relationship of prey and predators. Okay. Now there is another term. You have heard the term amensalism. Okay. So there is another term which is the commensalism. There is a opposite form of commensalism is the amensalism. In commensalism, what you have seen? In commensalism, you have seen one partner is benefited, another is neither benefited nor harmed. Amensalism is one partner is harmed, but another partner which is harming the second partner is not getting any benefit from it. Okay. So there are some of the example of the amensalism or amensalistic relationships are competition and envy biases. Okay, here we'll see. Okay, the competition is basically what? There is so many individuals of a species, they are competing for food, for space, light, oxygen, or any other need which is common to all, okay? And this competition may be of two types, the intra-specific competition or inter-specific competition. So in the intra-specific competition means the individual of the same species, they are competitive with each other. It's like some of the large fishes, they are preying the smaller fishes of the same species, okay? Or even if we talk about the interspecies, like some of the fishes eating the larvae of the mosquito, or some large carnivorous fish eating the smaller herbivorous fishes. Okay, so basically, isme kya ho raha hai ki, so that is the competition. Okay, this is amenalistic relationship. So the competition has a negative interaction between two or more species that utilize the same shared or the limited resources. Then the antibiosis. Antibiosis means an organism is either damaged or killed by a chemical reaction of the other organism. That is what the antibiotics which is released by a particular organism, it kills the surrounding bacteria and all. That is also one of the example of the amenalistic relationship. Okay, means the bacterial toxic which is released from a particular bacteria which is killing the other microorganism is not getting any benefit by means killing those other organism. Okay, or from this chemical secretion, if the other organism get damaged or killed, they won't get any benefit from that. Okay, so this is the one of the example of the amenalistic relationship. So this is about the animal association. Now this is one of the comparative sheets between the different type of animal relationship. When we talk about the mutualism, both the species get the favor from each other. Okay, commensalism, species A get the benefit, species B not benefited, neither benefited nor harmed. In parasitism or exploitation, one species get the benefit, another species harmed. Okay, in the predation, one get the benefit, another get the harm. In competition, both are means harm. None of the species is getting the benefit. So this is a comparison of the animal association. So this is about today's class. If there is any confusion, you may